Good evening, brothers and sisters. Body of Christ across around the world. Here again at Speaker's Corner. Loving the Muslims, loving the Hebrew Israelites, loving everybody that doesn't know Jesus, and urging them to come to the truth of Jesus Christ. Things have gone well today. People have heard the truth. Keep praying for them. Keep praying for us that we're in the field, right in amongst it.
Chapter 28. If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully follow all his commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations on earth. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. You will be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed, and the crops of your land and the young of your livestock, the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks. Your basket and your kneading trough will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. The Lord will grant that the enemies who rise up against you will be defeated before you. They will come at you from one direction, but flee from you in seven. The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hand to. The Lord your God will bless you in the land he has given you. The Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on oath, if you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in obedience to him. Then all the peoples on earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will fear you. The Lord will grant you abundant prosperity in the fruit of your womb, the young of your livestock, and the crops of your ground, in the land he swore to your ancestors to give you. The Lord will open the heavens, the storehouse of his bounty, to send rain on your land in season and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. The Lord will make you the head, not the tail. If you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be at the top, never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from any of the commands I give you today, to the right or to the left, following other gods and serving them.
Give me a reason why I should be a Muslim. Give me a reason.
Pinky and Perky.
Give me a reason why I should take Shahada.
No reason.
The reason why he should be a Christian is because he will be set free, and free indeed.
Amen.
Christ said, come unto me, all those who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Rest for your souls. The wicked run when no one pursues them. They have no answers. Every week is the same story. God help them. Pray for them. Love them. Rebuke them. Stand steadfast. Be immovable in the Holy Spirit. Do not let their mocking and their harsh truths lead you astray. Do not be discouraged by their bullying and their attacks and ad hominems. Stick to the truth of the gospel and rebuke them so that everyone will fear the name of Jesus Christ and revere him as the Creator. judgment comes, then we know where to run. Nowhere. Christians, I want you to think very carefully. I want you to think very carefully. Do not become a dour mule. Do not come to this park and say, we don't want to offend the Muslims. We don't want to offend the Muslims. We don't want to speak about Muhammad. Do not become a dhimmi in this park when this is the only place we have freedom of speech. You can speak the truth. Speak about Muhammad.
That's right.
So what?
That's right.
Do not let them subject you and subjugate you when you don't even realize what's happening. Sleight of hand dawah. That's what they want to give you. Sleight of hand dawah and hatred in the heart. God bless you.
What should our relationship with the Jews be in this day and age? The general principle in Al-Islam of al-bara wal-wala.
Of al-bara wal-wala. Of al-bara wal-wala.
This was explained by Ibn Qayyim and many others, is to love and to hate for the sake of Allah, which is simply summed up as loving the Muslims and hating the non-Muslims.
Well, there's a disassociation we're going to have, a barat we're going to have from you, you know, and a walat we're going to have to Islam and its people.
Being loyal to the Muslims and not being loyal to the non-Muslims.
That's what they want to give you. Sleight of hand dawah and hatred in the heart.
Hey, why do you think Muslim prophet and Jesus?
Shamsi, the great scholar of Hyde Park, runs from Jesus Christ when I speak his name. Is that how powerful Islam is?
Huh? Why do you talk more about Jesus than Islam?
They want to silence you. Don't talk about Islam, speak about Jesus.
Maybe you say you love Jesus.
Let's talk more about Islam. Let's talk about what your prophet said about Jews and Christians. Your prophet said that we are the worst of creatures, that we are pigs and swine, that we are filthy in body and soul, excuse me, that we are filthy in body and soul.
Islam is not only a religious offensive against Christ and everything that he taught, but it's a political offensive as well.
Many of us consider Islam equal to Christianity. Christianity or Judaism is a religion. Islam is not merely or only a religion. Islam is a way of life based on a religion. So, Islam is a political allegiance. Islam is a political system. Islam is a financial system. Islam is a social system. Islam is a personal life. Islam covers everything.
When they realize that their arguments aren't working, they will, as they've been recently doing, develop defamatory and slanderous narrative about people that are causing damage to Islam.
You messing with? What are you looking at? You fucking bitch!
Oh,
you see that Bini Hijab and Ali Dawas called CP and called him all kinds of evil things last week. Apostate prophet, they accused of some filthy, sickening things. Myself, yourself, the names I've heard them called Godwin and Daniel, just to try and get a rise out of us. And fortunately, we're full of the Holy Spirit. We have to be aware that when people really do start to create these defamatory narratives about us and try to spread them around, they want to discourage us. But we should know when they start to do that, they're running out of arguments.
High five!
We should know that and take strength from it.
So just, I want to emphasize one point you made. It is very important for Christians, not only for our own faith, for our own relationship with God, but also the God we worship affects our evangelism, affects the way we preach Him. Therefore, we must faithfully study Scripture. And we do have amazing minds out there who helps us to learn our Scripture, who helps us to love our God better. So please hang up those people, David Wood, Christian Prince. Grab the information as much as you can, because if you don't know God you worship, what are you gonna preach to others? It is very easy to critique the ideologies. It is very easy to make someone to not Muslim, but atheism is not the solution to the world.
Who wants to be a drag queen when they grow up?
Is not the solution to the world. Like, I'm so convinced solution to everything is Lord Jesus Christ. So whatever you destroy the ideology, you need to give them the hope, you need to give them life itself, you need to give them Jesus. Therefore, we need to know our Bible. And when we are grounded in our Scripture, there is no one or nothing can destroy us, because we have most powerful with us.
Jesus is the answer.
Yeah.
Everybody's looking for an answer. Everybody's looking. And you know, it occurred to me the other day, and I'm sure it's occurred to many, many millions of Christians and probably a lot more Muslims, that they want to be free.
Yeah.
There's no freedom in Islam.
People are just seeing that they're seeing, honestly, the lunacy, because when you're indoctrinated in that stuff and everybody around you is saying the same thing, you never stop to question it. And then when somebody says something else, you just feel like a complete moron. You're like, whoa, how could I have believed that this whole time? Like, you just feel like an idiot. Like, a lot of non-Muslims know Islam a lot more than even Muslims do.
Right.
Like, so many people studied Islam after 9/11 because they're really trying to figure out, like, what is this religion? And most Muslims never even study their own religion. They don't know anything about, they haven't even read the Quran, let alone the hadith and the seerah. They don't know anything. And so they go online and they start arguing, right? Like, whatever it is, Muhammad was the first feminist. And then they have these, all these people coming back at them with evidence and proof and like receipts. And it shakes their faith.
The truth, which is that our beloved Prophet Muhammad was a human rights activist. He was a feminist.
Feminist
in his own right, uplifted the women in his community.
There's no freedom in Islam. There's absolutely none. There's Muhammad. We know that Muhammad has bribed people to join Islam. We know that Muhammad has bribed people to join Islam.
Okay, got money in the bank. Yeah. Shout out what you drank. I got money in the bank. Yeah. Shout out what you drank. I got money in the bank. Yeah. Shout out what you drank. I got money in the bank.
Yeah.
Shout out what you drank.
I'ma get that dough and fuck with them. Young ladies that know me know strap is a pro. Fill up at the bar. Go get a massage. Buy me a couple. We can make it a menage. You be trying hard, but you don't start. You be doing this shit, gon' get you to the mall. I go get that paper, I make a
got that money in the bank.
Yeah.
Shout out what you drank. I got money in the bank.
Yeah.
Shout out what you drank. I got money in the bank.
We know that Muhammad bribed people to stay in Islam. We know that Muhammad controlled the minds of people and put fear into them in order to make them stay by ridiculous hadith. Like if you lift your eyes to the sky while you're praying, you'll go blind. Or if you lift your head before the imam, your head will turn into a donkey.
Ali.
Or, you know, be careful when you go into the toilet because it's full of devils. Or, you know, be careful when you go into the toilet because it's full of devils.
Okay, I'm going. Take off.
See ya. Be careful when you go into the toilet because it's full of devils. Careful when you go into the toilet because it's full of devils.
I know people are not encouraged to ask questions, but how can still after someone hears those things, they still stuck in that ideology?
This guy controlled everything about people, and he even controlled their free thinking, so that once we know that Surah 5101 said that you mustn't ask questions, and the reason you mustn't, you see, it's with Surah 5101, it says if something troubles you, so he's put something there just in case somebody begins to recognize he's a fraud. If something troubles you, don't ask questions. And then he goes on in Surah 5102, and the reason you mustn't ask is because people left Islam before you. So he's made them blindly faithful to him.
Okay, could I respond, brother?
Okay.
As a Muslim, listen, we don't use our brain. If Allah contradicts our brain, we take our brain out of the sight. We take our brain out of the world, you understand?
That's wonderful.
We use Allah
so,
and him.
So what do you use? If you don't use your brain, what do you use? What do you use? If you don't use your brain, if you just told me, we Muslims, we don't use our brain. Okay.
Yes.
So what do you use?
If it contradicts to Allah.
Hmm. So now your brain contradicts the stupidity of Allah, so you decide to throw your brain in the bin.
One more thing, man. And you're not allowed to use this.
You have children.
You're not allowed to use this.
You're not allowed to use your brain.
No.
So to be a Muslim, you can't use your brain.
Yeah, you shut your brain.
Are you here?
Yes.
To be a Muslim, you have to shut your brain.
Shut your brain, yeah.
Are you a Muslim?
Whatever God said.
Do you agree with him?
Yes. Whatever God said. Are you a Muslim?
So you believe to be a Muslim? You have to shut your brain.
Yes, you have to shut. You don't use your brains at all.
So we have confirmation, to be a good Muslim, you have to not use your brain.
What do you mean? Shut my brain off?
Yes, you don't use your brain.
You have to learn. Have to learn.
My friend, if your religion tells you to shut off your brain, I invite you to something better. No. Christianity, which allows you to use your brain and your intellect to analyze things that happen. Christians do not need to shut their brain off, because he's saying, so you have to then, as a Muslim, accept that God has said that the sun sets in a pool of water.
Whatever.
Which we know science.
Where do you get that from? Where do you get
in the Quran.
In the Quran, yes. Sun sets on water.
Yes.
On top of that, he's become some kind of mafiosa, where he's threatened them that if you do leave, if you do start free thinking, we will kill you. Some kind of mafiosa, where he's threatened them that if you do leave, if you do start free thinking, we will kill you.
أنت مسلم الحاج؟
أيه.
مغربي ولا
مسيحي؟ أنا مغربي مسلم.
وأنت مسلم مغربي ولا مسيحي؟
لا ما.
شنو حق الشغل فيه الدين؟
أنا ما متفقش معه.
شنو نديرو معه؟
ها؟
شنو الحق نديرو معه؟ ما ندوش معه؟
غادي نحرقوه معه.
نحرقوه؟
نحرقوه ولا نقتلوه.
حرقوه ولا نقتلوه؟
صافي.
بحال داعش؟
داعش.
نوليو داعش؟
لا.
غير نحرقوه بلا داعش؟
لا داعش.
نحرقوه بلا صافي؟
ما داخلينش داعش حنايا.
لا ما يمكنش نتعايش معاه، حيت حنا بلد اسلام، حنا خاصنا نآمنوا بالله والصلاه وبزاف د الحوايج. ما واحد نتعايش معاه نقدر ننصحو باش ما يديرش هذا الشيء.
صافي. الملحد ما يمكنش تعايش
معاه. لا ما يمكنش نتعايش
معاه. طورك راسك، الا بدلتي الدين الاسلامي انا نقطع لك راسك، واخا تكون صاحبي. تخرج من الدين الاسلامي؟ بون ابيتي خويا عبد الله.
زيد
ابيتي. اللي بدلتي الدين الاسلامي بون ابيتي خويا عبد الله. صافي من الاخر. بالنسبه ليا ما نقدرش نكون مع الناس اللي هما ملحدين اللي هما خارجين على بالنسبه ليا الدين الاسلامي لانهم يقدروا يشوشوا لي افكاري ويغيروا لي افكاري وربما انا نتبعهم في الطريق ديالهم بالنسبه ليا انا ما نقدرش نمشي معاهم
باعتبار اننا دوله اسلاميه ما يمكنش نعيشوا مع الملحدين في بلاد وحده
قال لي تحول شنو خصنا نديروا
تدير ما جو دابا هذا خصو يخوي البلاد يمشي بحالهم من هنا يخوي علاش ولا كيبقى انا خصو خصنا نديروا لهم الكنيسه ديالهم واش بغينا هنا بهاد الكنائس كاع حقيقه كاع
شرعا هو تيتم اخبار الحاكم بان الانسان ارتد للاسلام الحاكم تيعطيه الاخبار ديال 3 ايام يعني الا ما رجعش للدين ديالو تيجو واجب القتل ديالو
يقتل
لانه مرتد
فينا في الدين اخويا
يعني انا بحكم السؤال ديالي لواحد الشخص كبر مني يعني راجل ملتزم هذا هو يعني الجواب
ديال اللحيه ملتزم
يعني انسان يعني عالم ماشي
become some kind of mafioso where he's threatening them that if you do leave if you do start free thinking we will kill you
please don't insult mafias
you will lose your family you will lose your friends you will have to up and move If you're living in the West, you will be ousted and excommunicated from the community, or even worse.
Or even worse.
What is the penalty for apostasy? What is the penalty for leaving the Muslim faith? Dr. Mukaddam, what is the penalty for apostasy?
If it's an Islamic country, then the Sharia is very clear. Apostasy is dealt with the death penalty.
Thank you, that's all I want to hear.
But what's the relevance between what happens in an Islamic country and Great Britain? I fail to see the connection.
Oh, really? Let me know, do you want the UK to become a Muslim country? And what happens if that happens?
Bismillah, brothers and sisters.
There's no principle that demeans, degrades, and dehumanizes women more than the principle of Sharia law.
I don't believe Islam can reform itself. I don't believe in the reformability of Islam.
Ex-Muslim because I've lived under an Islamic regime of Iran and I don't want it at all anymore in my life.
Hi everyone, my name is Aisha and I am a Tunisian American member of Ex-Muslims of North America.
I'm a Swedish ex-Muslim, a former Muslim. I used to be a Muslim for nearly 20 years. I left Islam because I realized I couldn't really reconcile the teachings of the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad with my own morals, my own beliefs, my own consciousness.
You are Arabic speaker and by God's grace today you are child of God because you left Islam and you decided to follow our risen Lord.
Yes, so I was born in a Muslim country in the Middle East. I was born in a Muslim family. And life for me was just like any other Muslim girl. My family were a middle-class family. They were very devout. So my parents were very strict Muslims before they even met. And their marriage was based on Islam. Many people in my family, they are Hafiz, which means memorize the Quran by heart. And growing up, my life is very much was central around Islam. So I would go to, in the holidays, I would go to mosque to learn the Quran and tajweed, you know, the proper instruction and recitation. And that was in the Middle East. So it wasn't like the West where they just go to mosque for an hour with some Urdu speaking sheikhs. It was with proper Arab speaking sheikhs. And my family, like I said, they cared so much about Islam. They used to pay them for sort of private tuition. The problem is once you start asking one question, you start asking another question and the whole thing tumbles and falls apart. The first question I asked was personal. Why am I not feeling God's presence? Why am I the same as a non-believer? I woke up every morning with anxiety in my heart, like I was alone in the world, like everything is going to fall apart any minute because God was not on my side. And there's no way to know if Allah is on my side or not, because living as a Muslim is like living a constant guessing game. You pray to him, you don't know if he answers your prayers or not. You ask for forgiveness, you don't know if he'll forgive you or not. You do all this work for him, you don't know if he'll send you to Jannah or not. That's why when you ask Muslims, are you going to go to heaven? They'll say, inshallah, if Allah wills. They don't know. Why don't I know anything? Why aren't you giving me anything? And Allah in Islam is not like God of the Bible. You have a relationship with him. There's no such thing as a relationship. That word isn't in the Quran. What there is duties. You do your duty to Allah every day and you just wish for the best. And after a point, the anxiety becomes so much. Well, for me was that, when do I find out? Oh, you find out after death. Well, by then it's too late. So that's not good enough, you know. And I also always felt that even when I was giving charity or doing good work, that I was bribing Allah. You know, in my heart, I was like, look, I'm doing this for you. You know, make sure you do 10 good points for me in my balance of good works. So are you seeing this sort of thing? That's what was happening inside. And I felt that that's not the right way to think about God, to feel like you're bribing him with good works. So he'll accept you. Well, for me, it was to escape hell. If you read the Quran, yeah, there's a lot more about hell. And a lot of fear. So I knew what men would get in heaven, in paradise, and that for me, it wasn't going to be that much, but at least I wouldn't be burning in hell. And unfortunately, I kept wanting to buy Allah because I had no other option. What else was I going to do? I knew there was a God, obviously, because like I said, my background is the sciences, so I would study, you know, God's creation, and it's so amazingly intricate and complex. I knew there was a designer. I knew there was a God. I wasn't going to be atheist. So where is he? Obviously, he's in Islam. He's not, you know, with the Christians who believe in three gods. He's not with the Hindus who believe in lots of gods. You know, he's not in all of, obviously, he's in Islam. So I have to buy, he's my only option. So I have to buy his love. I have to try and buy this Jannah. So no matter what I did, I would never get peace in my heart. I would still, I knew there was things inside me that were not right. Like, in my heart, sins of the heart, and I knew that he could see it, and there was no reassurance. Like I said, it's like a hamster in a wheel. You would work, but you don't get any, there's no way to know where you stand with him. There's no sign, no way to know if he's on my side or not. And when I asked the question, how do I get close to Allah, the answer would always be, you need to work more, read the Quran more, try more, make your heart more sincere. But every time I read the Quran, I felt worse because it didn't sound like God. It sounded like a human. Like even the way he talks about hell, very sadistic. I will pour boiling water over your head. I will drag you through chains. I will put you into boiling oil until your skin falls off, and then I'll give you new skin so you'll be more tortured. And you thought you were honorable and noble, but you know, taste the fire. It sounded like a sadistic, you know, person who enjoys torturing people. It doesn't sound like God. And even paradise, it's all about, sorry to say, like sex and men and women and eat food. Is this really God? Like, when I read the Quran, I became less sincere. And it disturbed me, and it made me feel further away from this person that I'm trying to get to close to.
And how did you left Allah and Muhammad behind?
It was by God's doing. So towards the end of it, I realized that the thing that's between me and God, stopping me from feeling his presence, which is what I wanted, was my sin. And I don't know how that thought came into my head. It was by God himself, I think. That's the reason why.
You weren't still feeling good enough for God.
No.
And then, okay, because I don't feel good enough for God, I don't feel his presence. It must be, it's me.
It's me,
not him, it's me.
Yes, yes. Well, I deep down, I knew God was perfect. Even with all the bad things in the Quran and Muhammad's life, I knew God was perfect. So it must be me, like you say. So I searched Islam to find a way to get rid of my sin completely. And as you know, there are two ways in Islam. One is to die in battle, you know, for the sake of Allah, as a shaheed, as a martyr. So obviously I wasn't going to do that. The second thing was to go to Hajj, and you can get your sins forgiven until you come back. So you'll have this short time of no sin. So I wanted that. So I did go to Hajj, yes.
How much did you pay for it, sister?
At the time, it was with this journey and stay, it was £5,000 per person. And I also took my dad because he needed a chaperone as a woman. So that was £10,000. All my savings at the time.
My heart goes out to Muslims because when I'm speaking, I try to pick up really ridiculous things to get them to question the ridiculousness and the idiocy of Allah and Muhammad. And when I can see it in their eyes and you can see they're trapped because they look around the park, see other Muslims looking at them and realize that even if they feel like laughing at the ridiculousness of hadith, they can't. Or, you know, if they feel like asking me a question, they have to wait because they don't want their brothers to see that they're coming over and inquiring about something. And people have waited until the park's been a bit empty and come over to me or come over to you probably. I've heard people being contacted outside of the park because there is a fear factor that we have to be aware of.
Yeah.
And many, many people are leaving over the internet.
My dear brothers and sisters, because of the internet, we don't have the luxury to be in our beautiful bubble anymore. Because of the internet, I am strongly against ignoring the bigger problems out there and just teaching these half Sunday school myths. I have talked to too many people who have left the faith of our own children. And they say to me, we were taught lies. We were taught untruths. It's not correct what we were taught.
Many, many people are leaving over the internet because of DCCIC. So your ministry is blessed amongst others. I keep reading some really good comments from Indonesia and all over the place where people want to know. People really do want to know because they can't speak Arabic.
In America, this is the last thing, 23% are becoming apostates of Muslims, American-born That's Muslims. Why.
And if we don't take constructive steps to deal with this, it is going to become an avalanche, a tsunami that is going to hit our community in such a way that we will have a very difficult time standing. It will knock us over. A tsunami that is going to hit our community in such a way that we will have a very difficult time standing.
What a loving man he was! Islam is a hateful religion. It is an antichrist religion. It is sent by the devil to tell you that Jesus never died. When he died for you, he died so that you could live.
Make up your mind.
He died so that you could live. He died so that you could live.
How can God die?
And if you do not believe that he is Lord,
how can God die? How can God die? How?
How can God die?
How?
Now this is the insincerity of Islam.
No, how can God die?
Will you answer my question if I ask you?
I'm asking you.
I'm asking you, will you answer my question?
I'm asking you, how can God die?
God never died.
Ah, Lord Jesus, God.
Don't be rattling off.
No, Lord Jesus, God.
God never died.
Okay,
Jesus died in the flood. He died in the flood.
He
died in the flood. He is the eternal word of God. Everlasting to everlasting.
Lord Jesus, God.
He did not die.
No, you said Jesus was God.
But he rose in bodily form.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. She came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, told all these things to the 11 and to all the others.
I saw him.
But they did not believe it.
I think I'm mad. Peter, see the tomb for yourself.
So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen.
Now do you believe me?
He saw and believed.
He's back!
While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. He gave them this command: "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Then Jesus said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
well, at that time, a baby in the family was born, my nephew. And over, you know, the sort of the next few weeks, I loved that baby so much. I started thinking, I wish God loved me as much as I love this baby. And that's when I realized that the God of Islam isn't true, because how can I love more than God can love? That would make me bigger than God. And therefore, we must have God wrong somehow. He can't be like this. God is somewhere else. And that's when I decided Islam was false. And I asked God directly for the truth. I didn't do it with any wudu. I didn't face Mecca. I didn't do it in the way the Muslim prayer is. I just spoke to God like a Christian. I didn't know that that's how Christians prayed, but I just looked up and spoke to God and said, give me the truth. I want the truth. I don't care where you are. I know it's not here. Please, the truth. And I asked quite insistently every day, the truth, please, the truth, God, the truth. Why aren't you showing me the truth? So I was online, and because I typed in so many sheikhs on YouTube, one of the suggestions was a YouTube video between a brother in Christ, actually, and a Muslim. And it was a debate, and I clicked on it by accident, and now I know it's by God's providence. And I heard for the first time a Christian talking about Jesus Christ, a Christian who knew Jesus Christ. And he talked about him in such a way that his argument was so logical and so compelling and so amazing that I wouldn't say I believed then, but it kind of made me curious that who is this person speaking about Jesus in a way I never heard before. And he made a very good point to the Muslim that, you know, he said, even in the Quran, Christ is called the Word of God. And obviously the Word of God is eternal. So that means Jesus Christ is eternal. And that must mean that he is God. And I'm a logical person. So to me, I'd read this that verse in the Quran so many times, and I'd never thought of it that way. And I really think that God doesn't leave himself without witness, even in verses of the Quran. And that made me read a bit about, start looking into Jesus Christ, you know, very simple things online. Who is Jesus? What is salvation? What did he do? Is there any evidence for crucifixion? Is there any evidence for resurrection? But then again, I came to a point of confusion where honestly, I didn't know which side was right. I didn't know, because on one side, the Muslim side, it says, if you believe Jesus is God, you're going to hell because he's a man. And the Christian side is saying, if you don't believe Jesus is God, you're going to hell because he's God. Obviously, one of them had to be true, and they couldn't both be true at the same time. So which one is it? And so I was at that point, like, I need to find out the real answer. And God was gracious to me, and that I watched a video where somebody said, a Christian pastor, he said, if you don't know, ask Jesus himself. And like I said, I'm a logical person. So if the question is about Jesus and he's God, then surely he's the best person to answer that. If he's able, and if he's God, he will be able to answer it. So like I said, I have a scientific background. So I decided to experiment, since I was now going to hell anyway. I'm already misguided by Allah. So I decided to ask Jesus himself. I went down on my knees, and just like the man said, and as I did that, the tiniest part in my heart opened to the possibility it could be true. And I said, Jesus, if you are like what Christians are saying, show me. And in that moment, I still can't explain it, sister. It was like I was in another dimension for about a minute. Like, I felt waves of warmth in my chest, complete safety and happiness and acceptance, love. I'm not gonna cry. And like I've never felt in my whole life, my first ever contact with God. Like, and I really sensed his presence. Like, everything in the room looked shiny to me. It was like I was embraced by someone pure and holy, and I was completely changed in that moment. That's when Jesus came into my life. And so when that happened, I was shocked because I was still Muslim technically. I said, oh my goodness, that man is right. He's a man on YouTube is right. Jesus is right, you know, he is, something is there. So I went out and bought a Bible and I read it for the first time.
Islam is the religion of peace. You've got perfect relationship with your family. Everything is all happily after every time you visit one another. Red flowers comes with chocolates.
No, well, at the beginning, I was afraid. I was a secret believer for 6 months. So what I did is I wore the hijab. I was a hijab girl on the outside. And on the inside, I was a believer in Christ. Like I would carry my Bible in my bag. I would read it in my room. Like at break times at work, I would read it. And then unfortunately, because I have a big mouth, I couldn't keep it for much longer. So at that time, I found a church and they were praying, and I took my dad out because I knew that he wouldn't make a scene in public to tell him, because I needed, also my mind needed to tell my family, because how would I leave them, you know, going to hell, and I have the truth, I need to show them. So I told him everything I told you, and I told him, Dad, if we need to all come to Jesus Christ, or our family's going to hell. And that was one of the scariest times of my life, because people had been praying and things. The reaction wasn't violent, but everything else bad that you can think can happen has happened. I went back to live with my family to show that I'm not going to walk away because I'm a Christian. I want to be part of the family. I love you. I still love you, but I've just found the truth. And the reaction from them was obviously try and get me back to Islam. So I spent hours like being forced to watch Zakir Naik videos, which are like hours and hours. All of them sat with me, talking with me for hours. What are you doing? You're destroying yourself. Why, you know, my brothers and sisters, you know, why are you doing this to my, you know, mom and dad? They were good parents to you. Even one of them was very practical. He said, well, why did you just bring this up? You could have kept it to yourself. You know, you're just bringing heartache to our family, because this doesn't just bring shame on me. It brings shame on them, because people will look at them and say, you haven't raised her properly. And I said, well, when it comes to judgment day, you look at me and say, why did you keep this to yourself when it was the truth? So that's what I'm doing now. I'm telling you the truth. And unfortunately, it's not up to me, but it was up to them that they couldn't associate with me anymore, because, you know, I'm an apostate, you know, I'm a kafir.